Hachette Audio presents Physical Disobedience, an unruly guide to health and stamina for the modern feminist. Written and read by Sarah Hayes Coomer. This program contains a bonus PDF.
For everyone who has ever felt like a pufferfish. Author's note. The names and identifying details of people mentioned by first name only in this book have been changed to protect the innocent. Body baggage can be a nasty business, but the stories that follow, the ones these anonymous souls were graciously willing to share, have steadied me and readied me to be a crime-fighting, bullshit-bashing, comfy-cozy-wearing ninja. Named or unnamed, they will do the same for you. Disobedience is the true foundation of liberty. Henry David Thoreau, Civil Disobedience. Part 1. Beauty Unhinged. Chapter 1. Strange Beauty. It's picture time, ladies. Smile pretty. Suck it in. Keep it tight. Arms on hips, twist your body, bend those knees. You know how we do. If you're small enough and easy enough on the eyes and ears, you'll blend right in. Nope. Not anymore. We're in the middle of a heavy lift here, and we're going to need our legs under us. There is precisely zero chance we will be able to achieve equal stature while chronically apologizing for our own perfectly healthy, unconventionally beautiful bodies. Women have made enormous progress over the last 200 years for gender equality and human rights. The feminist activists who came before us deserve ticker tape parades and a series of provocative documentary films in their honor. Sojourner Truth, Betty Friedan, Gloria Steinem, Shirley Chisholm, Diane Nash, and countless others were unrepentant revolutionaries doing the dirtiest work long before our time. They were bold and relentless, and they deserve better than what we're doing to our bodies today. They deserve us at our strongest. We've come a long way, but after all this time, we remain enshrined in hourglass, whisper-thin ideals perpetuated not only by the media, but by our own acquiescence. We have a mountain of work yet to do on a whole range of issues. You know the ones: equal pay, affordable health care, stronger gun laws, paid family leave, equal representation in government and business, criminal justice, financial reform, support for immigrant and refugee families, environmental conservation, preventing violence against women, minorities, and the disabled, and on. It's a hell of a list. We understand the work that needs to be done to advance human rights on a macro level. Movements are taking shape worldwide. Women of every ethnicity are running for office and standing up for disenfranchised people in all walks of life. But if we aren't grounded in our bodies in the first place, none of it will stick. As foot soldiers, we must do the work on a micro level to shift the conversations in our own minds and to feed our bodies. Women are, and will continue to be, at the heart of progressive change throughout the world. We vote in greater numbers than men, we invest tirelessly in our own educations and those of our kids, and we advocate for public health and safety policies that benefit the community as a whole. But before we can make seismic professional, economic, and sociological changes, we have to squeeze out of our Spanx and remember how it feels to breathe. With sweat in our eyes, air in our lungs, and music pouring boldly from our speakers. This book is a manual for how to bring our activism home, into our bodies, by way of pleasurable, purposeful self-care. Physical disobedience is any action that feeds, strengthens, or nurtures our bodies as a direct, unapologetic act of defiance. It is fierce appreciation for what our bodies can do, how they feel, and how they look in all of their imperfect glory. It's a concrete, immediately impactful way to push back that benefits each of us as individuals while simultaneously affecting positive social change. In other words, taking care of our bodies is a form of political action. Physical disobedience is about refusing to acquiesce, refusing to allow our bodies to be objectified by others, and taking a hard look at how we objectify them ourselves. It is feminism via fitness. We know how to care for the people we love. We need to make sure our own bodies are cared for as well, and that requires a hefty dose of appreciation and exploration. There is too much at stake. Our bodies make our work possible. Reducing them to decorative trinkets reduces our impact and destroys our experience of being alive. What do beauty, health, and power look like? According to popular memes, they look like pouty lips and bony shoulders. These images are well defined for us. They are the driving force behind the contorted rituals we inflict on ourselves in the name of glamour. But chronic dieting and unrelenting feelings of failure are the furthest thing from beautiful. They are ugly and damaging, and they sap us of vital energy. The notions embedded in our minds about our bodies not measuring up and all the menial tasks we must undertake to make them submit eat away at our ability to do what needs to be done. If we want to move on to the next phase of humanity where women have at least a 50% share in governance, from the school board to the presidency, because duh, we need to surgically remove these notions, one at a time. Learning as we go to hear the physical messages being transmitted through our body systems of pain, anxiety, fear, and fatigue, and address them head on with endorphins and fresh air, rather than burying them in fad diets or cinnamon crumb cake. Making peace. The summer after I graduated from college, I spent sunny afternoons in a dark one-room apartment staring at my body in a plastic full-length mirror that was stuck to my closet door with double-sided tape. The bottom left corner was always detaching from the door. I nudged it with my toe and it would stick for a moment before, pop, coming loose again. When I engaged in this charming self-analysis, I was usually wearing some incarnation of faded polyester lace underwear and no bra. I faced the mirror head-on, eyes narrow, stance wide, and let my breath go, watching flesh spill out over the elastic edges of my panties. I took stock. Boobs sagging, belly rolls, disgusting thighs, I can't believe I'm wasting my life in this body. I picked up my camera and snapped photos, front and side. I wish someone were there to take a picture of my cellulite, but no such luck. Probably for the best, nobody wants to see that anyway. I printed the pictures out and posted them on the refrigerator door. Gross. I figured if I could see for myself how revolting I was, I would find the motivation to do something about it. I was 22 years old, 5'7", 155 pounds. Seriously. That boring, overworked pattern went on for years. I took on diets and challenges to get my appetite and body fat under control. I planned workouts that sometimes happened, sometimes not, and cooked a bunch of vegetables that generally ended up in the trash a week later, slimy in Tupperware. I hovered a hair trigger above a state of panic, like SpongeBob SquarePants having a nervous breakdown at the sight of cake or fries or food of any kind. Even when I lost weight, the result never seemed beautiful. It never fit the image I had in my head of how I was supposed to look, how a powerful, confident woman should look. Thin, graceful, cheekbones for days, narrow limbs, and a liquid stare. That woman haunted me. A ghostly image I cobbled together from the usual suspects, billboards, movies, and fashion magazines. She hovered in my mind in every clothing store and at every buffet I attended from the age of 15 to 35, reminding me in no uncertain terms that I did not measure up. Her giant eyes, baggy sweaters, and skinny jeans beckoned. You can be beautiful if you just control yourself. Deprive yourself a little more. Find the right boots and lipstick, the right super cute workout gear, and you'll have arrived. You're a wreck. Lose the weight. It was whiplash, predictable and pointless. Weight loss and gain, cleanses, makeovers, diets, and half-hearted attempts at trending fashions. The obsession with manipulating my body in one way or another monopolized my bank account, my free time, and my brain year after famished year. My body was fine. It was more than fine. It was young and strong. But I spent 2 decades weakening it while shortchanging every other aspect of my life. The fight took me to my knees in front of toilets. It plagued me with stomach ulcers and depression. It prevented me from speaking my mind in social situations and asserting myself in professional ones. And it stopped me from exploring pleasures and possibilities that would otherwise have been open to me. I've tried to guess how many hours a day, in the thick of those years, I spent feeling awkward in my clothes and obsessing about food or exercise, but truthfully, I don't think there was any time at all when my body and its inadequacies weren't at least a little bit on my mind. I've tried to calculate what difference it might have made in my career, relationships, income, and mental and physical health if those years had been spent differently. But there is no going back to those summer afternoons in my discount underwear.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.